हेलो
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम,
कैन यू हियर मी?
हेलो,
यस मैम,
यस मैम।
ओके, वन सेकंड। Can you see the slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so today we'll discuss block 4, John Milton's poetry. Okay. So he belonged to the Commonwealth period, okay? Last class we have discussed about 17th century. 17th century poets have witnessed the reign of many kings, isn't it? I told you last week. So one second. Okay, about John Milton, what do you know about John Milton in general?
A poet who became blind towards the end of his...
Are you familiar with Paradise Lost, Paradise Regained?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Epic poetry, modern epic poetry. Okay, so John Milton, 1608 to 1674, English poet. Pamphletic historian and considered the most significant English author after William Shakespeare. I told you he's the most prominent poet during Commonwealth period. That means the period during Oliver Cromwell. Intellectual, and he's a Puritan poet. Okay, let me tell you, he's a Puritan poet. Last week we have studied poems of Andrew Marvell, George Herbert and John Donne, and I hope you remember that Andrew Marvell is the secretary of John Milton. Andrew Marvell is the secretary of John Milton. He was a blind poet, right? So Andrew Marvell worked as a secretary. Intellectual who served as a civil servant for the Commonwealth of England during its Council of State and later under Oliver Cromwell. Now, so he introduced new words into English from Latin and ancient Greek. And apart from that, this person has got a nickname, Lady of Christ, because this person's features are very much similar to a female. So for that reason, he was known as Lady of Christ. Lady of Christ. He was graduated from Christ College. That is why he was known as Lady of Christ. The first modern writer to employ unrhymed verse outside of the theatrical translation. So till then, Canterbury Tales, then in Epithalamion, Prothalamion, and till 17th century, most of the poets, they have exploited the use of heroic couplet. But this man wrote poems in blank verse, unrhymed, iambic pentameters. Okay. So his age was age of transition. Why? I told you Charles Head was beheaded in 1649. From 1625 to 1642 was Carolian age. And in 1642, all theaters, civil war broke out, all theaters were closed. In 1649, Charles II, Charles I was beheaded and Oliver Cromwell came into power. Yeah. So from 1649 to 1660, that was a period of Puritanism, Commonwealth period. So Roman Catholicism had yielded to Protestantism and Puritanism. Okay. English, sovereign receded and parliament came into prominence. I mean, during that period, we had two type of political parties. I hope you are familiar with that, Whigs and Tories. I mean, those people who supported king and royalty, are Tories, and those people who supported Parliament are Whigs, Parliament, okay, Church. So, yeah. Then he also lived through the reign of Charles II, that is restoration of monarchy after 1660. And England has witnessed urbanization during that period. Now, so that's all about Milton and the background. So in this session, we can discuss about Nativity Ode, L'Allegro Prenestro, Lycidas, then two sonnets. So this is a long poem. We have 31 stanzas. So let me tell you, Milton wrote this poem when he was 21. This was his first major work in English. First major work in English, but this is not the very first work of Milton because he has also written in Greek and Latin. He was well versed in Greek, Latin. So on the morning of Christ's nativity, also known as Nativity Ode, was written in 1629 when Milton was only 21, published in 1645 in his collection of poems known as of Mr. John Milton. So he published this poem on his 21st birthday in commemoration of Nativity of Jesus. Let me tell you something. Even though this poem is a celebration of Jesus Christ's birth, this poem is also a celebration of a celebration of Oliver Cromwell. When he came into power, in order to praise him, he wrote this poem. You can take this poem in two ways. Is also praising Oliver Cromwell when he came into power in 1649. Okay, the poem speaks on the themes of coming age and religion. Poem not only celebrate nativity but also poet entry into adult world. It recognizes Milton's first great poem. Yeah. So I told you the poem, it described Christ's incarnation, the birth of Jesus Christ, and overthrow of earthly and pagan power. The poem also connects with incarnation, with Christ's crucifixion. So let me tell you, one side of the poem discusses about Christ's birth and overthrow of earthly and pagan power. Other side, it is very much symbolic. Okay, this poem is symbolic. He discusses about the very accession of Oliver Cromwell into the throne and how he has overthrown Charles I. Charles I and his followers are considered pagan power and earthly power. And here he equates Oliver Cromwell to Jesus Christ. Have you understood? If you read the poem, you will simply see this poem as a poem celebrating the very birth of Jesus Christ. But this poem has got another half. That is, he celebrates the very coming of Oliver Cromwell to the monarchy and how he has overthrown Charles I and his followers. I hope you got an idea. So at the time Milton wrote Nativity, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. At the time Milton wrote Nativity Ode, English Parliament resented Charles I for attempting to create taxation laws without their approval and for bringing ceremony back into church. So let me tell you, in 1642, only that privileged class enjoyed all rights. Rest of the class, rest of the people were suppressed. So when this person came into being, Oliver Cromwell came into being, even though he was strict, we have discussed about Oliver Cromwell in this class in Horatian Ode, I hope you remember. So where he is depicted or described as a very strict person who has retired from, who has resigned him from a normal life, so has to leave England. One month before Milton wrote Nativity Ode, Charles I's parliament to ask for money to fund his war, and the parliament refused. It was the first in a chain of events that eventually led to the parliament to execute the king. So this person, Charles I, was a womanizer and a spendthrift. I told you, only he and his follower enjoyed during that period. So when it reached the limit, parliament people, they have planned to execute Charles I. So Milton poem anticipate the beginning of a new era in English poetry. So from 1649, I told you, in this poem he anticipates a new era in English poetry. That means an era of happiness, then morality, then equality, etc. Okay, so that means he also discusses about the birth of Jesus Christ. Until the birth of Jesus Christ, actually the pagan power and earthly power, they reigned the earth. But soon after the birth of Jesus Christ, they lost their power. Once again, yeah. So this poem, it is divided into two sections. Introductory stanza, that is the hymn. Introductory stanzas and the hymn. So introductory stanza consists of 4 stanzas, then hymn, 27 stanzas. So introductory part is prefaced by 4 stanzas, 7 lines, each lines of iambic pentameter using rhyming scheme ABA, BB followed by rhyming couplet. Okay, ABA, BB, CC. That is the rhyming scheme of the poem. The final line of each line is written in iambic hexameter. Now, the hymn, which comprises of 27 stanzas. The hymnal stanzas are 8 lines, each uniformly written in iambic meter. The final 2 lines form a rhyming couplet with a line in tetrameter followed by a hexameter, which closes out each stanza. The first 6 stanza are made up of 2 tercets. 3 lines organized by rhyming scheme AAB, CCB. 2 tercets mean 3 lines. Okay. The first 2 lines of each tercet are in, trimeter. And the third line is in pentameter. So that's a very bad technical information about the poem. Now, I told you introductory stanza consists of, the introductory part consists of 4 stanzas. So if you have a textbook, you can see this is the month and this is the happy morn wherein son of heaven, eternal king of wedded maid and virgin mother born, our great redemption.
Page number, please.
Page number, one second. 45. Yeah. So this is the month and this is the happy morn wherein the son of heaven's eternal king of wedded maid and virgin mother born, our great redemption from above did bring. For the holy sages once did sing that he our deadly forefeet should release and with father work us perpetual peace. So in this stanza, poet says that savior was born, has a prophet, has perfect foretold, he has come to release us from the penalty of sin and bring eternal peace on earth. So this is the very this is the month and this is the happy morning. Poet says that this is the month of happy morning where the son of heaven eternal king, that is Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ is born, our great redemption from about did bring. He has born so has to save human beings from the penalty of sin. So has to save human beings from the penalty of sin and to bring eternal peace on earth. That's the first stanza. Now in second stanza, so he says that Jesus Christ has left heaven for the goodness of human being. He already belonged to the community of three, Trinity. He belonged to the community of three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Mm? Actually, he was a he is a king in heaven, mm? But he left that position so as to save his dear ones on earth. That is, he already belongs to the community of three, but for the love of his creation, he left the exalted position. That is the gist of second introductory stanza. Okay. Then, in third stanza, he says that, say heavenly muse shall not sacred vain. Heavenly muse, don't you have a gift for Jesus Christ? It's the night time. He's about to come. So he's preparing. So I told you this is a nativity ode where he celebrates the very birth of Jesus Christ. And also he says that hearing the very arrival of Jesus Christ, how other earthly and pagan God, how they flee away from him. 1 second. Yeah. Just a second. Now, in the third stanza, he says that wise men have reached, see how far upon the eastern road the star-led wizards haste order sweet. O runs, prevent them with thy humble oath and lay it slowly at his blessed feet. Have you, thou honored fest, thy Lord to greet, joy the voice unto the angels choir from our his secret altar touched with hallowed fire. So here he says that wise men have reached here. They have bought gifts for Jesus Christ, and they were led by the heavenly star. So the first stanza, first four stanza speak about the very arrival of Jesus Christ and how the entire world, and he's giving a description about Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is not an ordinary person. He belonged to the Trinity of three. And he's asking the nature, see, the great king is coming. Don't you have a gift for the baby? He is coming to save us from the penalty of sin and to bring eternal peace on earth. So that's the main gist of the first four stanza. I mean, first introductory stanza. I hope the it's clear. Now, I told you these are the list of pagan gods. I mean, earthly gods. See, in Egypt, China, then South America, Mexico, in so many places. Here John Milton treats all other deities and gods from other religion as pagan. Except Jesus Christ, he treats all other god as pagan god. Apollo, Greek and Roman god, god of light, truth, prophecy, etc. Anubis, god of dead, Egyptian god. Aten, then Brahma, Hindu god of creation. So he treats all other gods, deities, god and goddesses, deities from other religion as pagan god, false god. Okay, fake. Now, hymns. Hymnal stanza. I mean, there are 27 stanza in the hymnal part. I told you 27. Okay. So, hymn begins with a description of Christ's birth in the manger. As Christ, as Milton said the scene, he personifies nature as a woman clocking her sins in white snow, a frequent symbol of purity in Bible. His description of nature covering her sin echoes Eve's attempt to hide herself from God after the fall. Let me tell you something. Jesus Christ was born in the month of December, during winter season, isn't it? Where earth was covered with snow. So until then, our earth has got some illicit relationship with Apollo, that is sun god. But when Jesus Christ was born, She attempts to cover her sin, her mistake, using white snow. Okay, here white symbolizes purity. So have you seen that first answer? It was the winter while. While the heaven-born child, all meanly wrapped root manger lies, nature in awe to him, had off her gaudy trim with her great master to sympathize. It was no season then for her to abandon with son her lusty paramour. Okay, until then she was having fun with her lusty paramour's son. So it was in the middle of winter. Jesus Christ was born, man. Nature removes all her ornaments, just as Jesus Christ disrobed himself for glory. No more coveting. So she stopped all sort of entertainment with her parama son. Let me tell you something. See, during spring season, summer season, earth will be covered with various colors of flowers. But during wind season, there are no flowers. Simply, you can see white snow everywhere. In the western part, So there he compares earth to Jesus Christ. See, Jesus Christ has disrobed himself when he takes birth on earth, isn't it? He disrobed himself. Why? He's actually actually the king of heaven, but he came to earth to save the mankind. So he disrobed himself. So so has to serve Jesus Christ, earth. Okay, goddess earth. She also abandoned, removed all her ornaments, and she is just covered with a white blanket. White blanket means white snow. Now she doesn't have any kind of ornaments, embellishments, no flowers, nothing to decorate herself. Until then, she was having fun with her parama son. During summer and spring season, she's she decorated herself with various colors of flowers, etc. But during winter season, she doesn't have any kind of ornaments. So she is as naked as the newborn baby. You understood? Now, second stanza. Only the speech. Well, speech is fair, and she woos the gentle air to hide her guilty from the innocent snow, and on her naked shame, polluted with the sinful blame. So now earth is naked. Nature feels ashamed. She asks the wind to cover with a white veil, so has to hide the indecency, thus make her presentable to coming king. So I told you in the previous stanza, she removed all her clothing because Jesus Christ is also born naked, isn't it? So earth also now removed everything. Now she is asking the wind to give her some garments, so has to cover herself. She wants to be presentable in front of Jesus Christ. That is why she has worn white blanket, that is white snow. Just a second. Can you hear me? Hello, I'm back.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, yeah. In the third stanza, but he, her fears to see, sent down the meek-eyed peace. She crowned with olive green cane slowly slidingly down through the turning spear. Yeah. So in third stanza, God sends down peace to prepare the king's way before Jesus Christ's arrival. God sends dove. I mean peace to earth so has to prepare his way. So breaking through the clouds, a turtle dove arrives. She comes crowned with an olive garland and waving a myrtle branch. You might have seen a dove's picture holding a myrtle branch, isn't it? In third stanza, poet says that before Jesus Christ's birth, God has actually sent a dove to earth so has to make his way, and the dove comes to earth by breaking the clouds. By breaking the clouds, how she comes, how she had reached the earth, she comes to earth with a olive garland and waving a myrtle branch. Okay, so now, in fourth stanza, no war, no battle sound was heard the world around. The idol spear and shield were high, uphung. The hooked chariot stood unstained, the hostile blood. Yeah. So, under her influence, that means under the influence of peace, all the armies of the world put away their swords. And King sensed that something is going to happen. Until then, people on the earth was fighting with each other. They were fighting for some reason. But once the dove hit the earth, peace in the form of dove waving that myrtle branch, when it hits the earth, they stopped fighting. I mean, the people on the earth stopped fighting under the influence of peace. Okay, until then, they were fighting with each other. So they sense that something is going to happen. They suddenly felt some kind of happiness, peace inside. So they started to feel that something is going to happen. Okay. Now, in stanza number 5, but peaceful was the night wherein Prince of Light, his reign of peace upon earth began. The winds with wonder were smooth. With water kissed, whispered new joys to the mild ocean. Yeah. So stanza number 5. So then the night that Prince born is come. See, I mean, Jesus Christ was born is in the month of Christmas, during nighttime, isn't it? The night that Prince born is come, it's reign of peace upon the earth. It is during the nighttime, the reign of peace upon earth began. Then wind kisses the ocean and whispered sweetly to them that they should start they should not what cease roaring. Okay, until then waves in the seas were roaring. Okay, so when Jesus Christ was born, wind whispered and kissed the ocean waves and told them that they should cease roaring. I repeat the fifth stanza. It was during a winter night that Jesus Christ was born. It is during that night the reign of peace began on earth. Okay, so at that moment, wind kissed the ocean. See, until then, before the birth of Jesus Christ, I mean, people, nature, etc., everything was very turbulent nature. But when Jesus Christ was born, every living thing and non-living thing started to feel something beautiful. Everything has calmed down. So wind kissed the ocean and whispered and told them that they should cease, they should stop roaring. Now, stanza number six, one second. Stars with deep amaze stand fixed in the steadfast gaze, bending one way their prettiest influence and will not take their flight, for all the morning light of Lucifer that often warned them thence, but in the glimmering orbs did glow. So, stars, see, seeing the baby Jesus Christ, stars are so fixed by the birth of King. They didn't retire for the morning until they were asked to go by the God, because stars, when they saw Jesus Christ, baby Christ in the barn, when they saw the baby Christ in the stable, they were so startled. They were so surprised. Why? Because they haven't seen anything so beautiful. Yeah. So Jesus Christ had exceeded those stars, the brightness of the stars in the sky. So they were so fixed in the sky and they didn't retire until morning. They were shining in the sky. Until, one second, until God asked them to go. Now, in the seventh stanza, and though the shady gloom had given day her room, the sun himself withheld his wanton speed and hid his head for shame, and his inferior flame, new enlightened world no more should need. He saw a greater sun appear, and his bright throne and burning electric could bear. So, until then, which was the brightest star in the sky? Sun was the brightest star in the sky. But after the birth of Jesus Christ, he felt ashamed. Who? Sun felt ashamed because a greater sun has taken birth on earth. None other than Jesus Christ. Though not yet in full bloom, night had given away to day. But sun has reduced his speed, reluctant to come. See, I told you previous stanza, stars were there till stars were there in the sky till morning until God asked them to go. Then sun is so reluctant to come outside. He's so reluctant to come outside. Why? Because he felt that he is far inferior to Jesus Christ. Okay, so that is a very summary of the seventh stanza. So in stanza, from stanza 3 to 7, Milton described the absolute peace that follows Jesus Christ's birth. He imagines battle ending, the ocean and stars stopping, and sun disappearing to make way for greater light of the Christ. So I told you, first seven stanza discusses about the very how, what the preparation of the preparations made by earth. Wind so has to receive Jesus Christ, the arrival of peace on earth, how battles, how people engaged in battle, how they have stopped fighting with each other. Then he also discusses about stars were so confused with the birth of Jesus Christ. Sun felt ashamed, for he felt that he is far inferior to Jesus Christ. So that's a very gist of stanza 1 to 7. Okay. Now, you can mark in your textbook, please mark stanza 1 to 7 forms the first section. Okay. Please mark there. Please mark. I forgot to incorporate in the slides stanzas 1 to 7. Now, moving on to stanza 8. The shepherd on the lawn over the point of dawn, stayed simply chatting in a rustic room. Full time thought they then that the mighty Pan was kindly come to live with them below. Yeah, so that stands the shepherds during evening. They were actually they are engaged in rustic conversation, thinking about their love, sheep, etc. Now, in stanza 9, when such music sweet their heart and ears did greet, as never was by mortally fingers through divinely warbled voice and answering the string noise, and all their souls in blissful rapture took. So, see, these shepherds, you know, who form music, drama, everything. Actually, according to Greek, it is shepherds who has created drama and all kind of art forms. They are the originators of all kind of music, drama, dance, etc. So when they heard the sweet music that took the heart and soul, they felt that no mortal could produce such a divine music. Divine voice has joined that celestial music. So until then, no creature on earth, no living things on earth, having heard such a joyous song. But when Jesus Christ was born, angels, cherubs in the sky, they started to sing. So, I mean, shepherds, all other living thing and non-living thing, they were wondered because till then they haven't heard such a divine song. That was a celestial song. Air also accompanied them. Okay, now in stanza number 10, nature that heard such sound beneath the hollow round of Cynthia's seat. Cynthia means moon, okay? The airy region thrilling now was almost one to think her part was done. And the rain had there its last fulfilling. She knew such harmony alone. Naturing on hearing such a divine music below, moon's kingdom, she felt that her part was done. She could produce such a harmony ever. So, after hearing that song, Cynthia, that is moon goddess, she felt that her part was done, because never in her life she can produce such a music. Now, stanza 11, at last surrounds their sight a globe of circular light that with long beams the shame fact night array, the helm cherubim and sword seraphim are seen in glittering ranks with wing displayed, harping in loud and solemn choir with unexpressive notes to heaven's newborn heir. So here in 11 stanza, poet describes about various, different types of archangels, cherubim, seraphim, etc. Okay. So, entire angels of the heaven, angels belongings to different ranks. At least I think those who belong to church or church related subject, I think you are familiar about the different ranks of angels, isn't it? So entire angels of heaven join the choir and they lit up the sky. So previous stanza we have seen that angels started to sing divine music when Jesus Christ was born. So entire angels of the heaven started to sing and they joined the choir. Now, stanza 11, 12. Such music as it is said, before was never made when of old sons of morning sung, while creator great his constellation set and well-balanced world on hinges hung. So, such a heavenly music was never made at the time of heaven's creation. See, when God created heaven and earth, also he has seen, the creature having heard such a great music, but they are hearing such a divine music for the first time. So in stanzas 8 and 9, Milton turns to a group of shepherds who hear the music of heaven from field and listen in amazement. Yeah, in stanza 10, he describes nature blowing to the power of music and suggests that music provided better harmony than physical laws governing the world. In stanza 11 and 12, a group of angels appear in the sky singing. The Milton compares the sound they make to the music that played during the creation of the world. So let me tell you, even during the creation of the heaven and earth, God hasn't produced such a beautiful music, but it is at the time of Jesus Christ's birth only. Entire world produced such a divine, celestial music. So 8 to 12 is all about shepherd, that activity, then song, etc. Okay. Now, stanza 13. Ring out crystal spheres. 1 second. Yeah. Ring out crystal spheres, once bless our human ears, and let your silver chime move in melodious time, and let the bass of heaven deep organ blow. With your ninefold harmony, make up full consort to the angel-like symphony. So in 13th stanza, stars and planets in the orbit join the heavenly music. It here says that, ring out the crystal spheres. Crystal spheres means here, celestial spheres. Okay, so not only angels, but celestial bodies, heavenly bodies like Jupiter, Venus, Mars, etc. join that song. Okay. For if such holy song enwrap our fancy long, time will run back and fetch the age of gold. So if they could do, then all vanity, sin, hell would shrink away from the earth. That means, see, for if such holy song enwrap our fancy long, time will run back and fetch the age of gold, and speckled vanity and will sicken soon and die. From leprous sin will melt from earthly mold, and hell itself will pass away and leave her lawless mansion to peering day. See, if entire earth and entire celestial body, universe, etc., if they can forget, or if they can, if it is possible for them to redeem or themselves, then they could come out of there. They could get rid of their sins. Okay, all vanity, sin, and hell with they can shrink. Hell will shrink. Now, stanza number 15. Yeah, true justice then will down return to men. Enameled arrays of rainbow wearing, the mercy set between the celestial sheen. So I told in previous stanza, entire universe started to sing. So if it is possible, if every creature, every living thing can, if they can also sing like this, then they could get rid of all their vanity, sin, etc., so that the hell the hell on the earth will shrink away. Okay. Now the 15th stanza, a poet says that justice, if all those unwanted things, that means all those evil things, if we are able to get rid of all those evil things from the face of the earth, truth, justice, mercy will return to earth to establish the throne. Actually, it was there at the time of creation, but due to our sinful ways, it had gone, isn't it? Due to our sinful ways, truth, justice, mercy, all these noble qualities had gone from the earth. But when Jesus Christ was born, all these qualities returned to establish their throne. So in stanza 13 through 15, Milton calls out the music to play again, announces that what will happen when it does, the final judgment, when time will stop and gates of heaven will open to all. What I have said. Now, moving on to 16th stanza, but wisest fate says no. So, but wisest of all the God, we need to wait, necessary to delay, such a haste action. Jesus Christ is still in an infancy state. To provide redemption, he must taste the bitterness of life. Okay, so but wisest say, no, this must not yet be so. Baby lies yet in smiling infancy, that on bitter crows must redeem our lows. In the introductory stanza, we have seen that Jesus Christ has come to earth, so has to save mankind. Yes, but wise people, they say that Jesus Christ is still in infancy state. In order to save the world, in order to provide redemption to entire mankind, he must first taste bitterness of life. He should go through suffering, then only he will be able to save. Okay, now Yeah, Milton pulls back from his divine vision to present the moment. He reminds himself that it must not yet be so. Because Christ has only just born, Milton returns to the present moment and summarizes the role of Christ plays in Christian doctrine, taking on a human form to die for sin. He then races back to future, this time imagining the other side of final judgment, how sinners will be judged as a dreadful dreadful trial. Now, one second. Now, moving on to 17th stanza. With such a horrid clang as on the mountain Sinai rang while the red and smoldering clouds outbreak. So just like Moses received enlightenment on Sinai mountain at the end of the world, God will come to judge the dead and living. In 17th stanza, he says that just like Moses received his enlightenment at the top of Sinai mountain, at the end of the world, he will come again, so has to judge the dead and living. Now, in the 19th stanza, then at last our blissful and perfect is but now begins from this happy day, the old dragon underground in straighter limits bound. Having come to the world, Jesus Christ having come to the world, the reign of those pagan gods has come to an end. Dragon, that symbolizes China. All those pagan gods in China. Okay, he became very angry when he saw the divine race of Jesus Christ. He understood that his reign on earth, his rule on earth is being threatened. That is what is said in 18th stanza. I told you in 18th stanza talks about how old dragon until then was reigning on earth. When he saw the divine ray of Jesus Christ, he understood that his rule has been threatened. His reign has been threatened. Yeah. Now, in 19th stanza, oracles are dumb and no voice or hideous hum runs through the arched roof in the world's deceiving. No oracles and deceitful prophecies can no longer reign on earth. That talks about temples of Delphi, temples of Delphi in Greece. So if you are aware about Greek mythology, you might have heard about oracles of oracles made by sages of Delphi. So no oracles, no deceitful prophecies can no longer reign earth. False prophets of Delphi, Apollo, and all other pagan gods have lost their power. Okay, priests and other hermits, they have rendered speechless by the birth of Jesus Christ. So in 19th stanza, he speaks about Roman Greek deities. Okay, in 18th stanza, the poet speaks about Chinese deities. Okay, so moving on to in stanza 18, Milton returns to the present and describing how Christ's birth was wounded Satan and who not half so far cast his usurped way. In stanza 19 through 26, Milton imagined the false idols of Greek Roman mythology retreating in the face of Christianity. The poem ends with Mary looking at her sleep son in the manger at her feet of ready angels surrounding them. Let's move on to the 20th stanza. Lonely mountain over and resounding shore, a voice of weeping heard and loud lament, and from haunted spring dale and edge the poplar pale. So, previous stanza we have seen that all those Roman Greek pagan gods have become very angry because when the reign on earth had been threatened. They are lamenting. The loud lamenting can be heard from the valley. Sound of weeping is echoed all over the seas and mountain. The guardian spirits are displaced from the places. Now, when Jesus Christ was born, angels, people heard the loud cries of all those pagan gods from valleys and mountains because they became very terrified by the birth of Jesus Christ. Now, 21, stanza number 21, in consecrated earth and on the holy earth, last lemmas mourn with midnight plain and urns and altars and a rarer and dying sound. So wails can be heard from the graveyard of evil spirits. Temple seems to sweat with fearful anxiety as their resident deities are taken flight. So Jesus Christ has made this earth. When he was born, the entire earth was filled with celestial light. So that pierced into the eyes of all those evil gods. So poet can hear the wailing. The wails can be heard from the graveyard of those defied spirits. Even deities in the temple. Temple of Delphi. Okay. I have already told you that all gods goddesses of other religion are treated as pagan. Except Jesus Christ, all other gods are treated as pagan. So he says that all other evil spirit and deities of the temple had taken their flight because they are very anxious about their existence. Now, moving on to stanza number 22. Peor and Balaam forsake the temple dim with twin battered god of Palestine and moon Ashtaroth. Yeah. So, heaven's queen and mother both. So, Pure, Baal, Dragon, these are different pagan gods. They have forsaken their temples. All those gods, deities of the temples, they have forsaken their temples. Candles that illuminated their shrines have snuffed out. Then Ashtaroth, Ammon, and they are Egyptian gods. Okay. Ammon retired in defeat. All those gods, they have retired in defeat. Now, moving on to stanza number 23. And Sullen Moloch had fled in shadow dread, his burning idol of all blackest hue, in vain with a simple ring, they call the grisly king, dismal dance about the furnace blue. So, in the middle of a sacrifice ritual, Moloch, see, previously there had been a tradition of throwing newborn babies into the fire so as to please the god. And there are so many other superstitious rituals so as to please this pagan god. So all those tradition and ritual has come to an end with the birth of Jesus Christ. So those people, those pagan gods are now not getting any kind of offerings and invocation from human side. So now they don't have any existence on earth. Now they are very much aware about that. So in the middle of the sacrifice ritual, Moloch fled from the burning idol. Okay, so they understood that they don't have any role on earth, so they fled from the earth. Now in stanza number 24, nor is also seen in Memphian grove or green, the trampling, the unshowered grace with lowings loud, nor can he be at rest within his sacred chest, not but profound as hell can be his shroud. So Orus is nowhere to be seen. He can be he can't be at play or at rest except in hell. Still his worshippers are searching for him from the temple to temple. So Orus is another pagan god. He is not seen at temple, nor he can be happy or in a relaxed position because Jesus Christ has taken birth. He has lost all his power. Let me tell you, he is a god from Egypt, Egyptian god. Okay, Orsis is an Egyptian god. So all his worshippers, and Egyptian people, they have a tendency to worship pharaohs, isn't it? They equate their king and queen to that of God. So that tradition has come to an end with the birth of Jesus Christ, Orsis. So now moving on to stanza number 25. He feels from Judah's land, the dreaded infant's hand, the rays of Bethlehem blind his dusky eye, nor all the gods beside longer dare abide, nor typhoon hues ending in snaky twine, our babe to shew his godhead true. So in this 25th stanza, the poet says that, see, blinded by the light from the Bethlehem, all gods, including Orsis and other, decided to flee from earth. So even in the baby state, Jesus Christ had the power to flee them away from earth. Okay, Jesus Christ still has the power to control all evil forces. One second. Now, moving on to stanza number 26. So when the sun is in birth, curtained with cloudy red, pillows his chin up on the orient wave, flocking shadows pale. Yeah. So in that stanza, sun, this evening sun sets down to his red bed to curtain and rest his head on the pillows of ocean. So evil cools march towards the jail which Jesus has made for them. So that evening on which Jesus Christ was born, all the evil things on earth marched towards the jail that Jesus Christ has prepared for them. Okay. I repeat. In the 26th stanza, poet says that there were so many pagan gods on earth. But after the very birth of Jesus Christ, silently, without stopping for a revolt or a rebellion, they silently marched towards the jail that Jesus Christ had prepared for them, arranged for them, because they know that they cannot stand against Jesus Christ, for he is the eternal king of the universe. But see, the virgin blessed hath laid her baby to rest. Time is of a tedious song should here have ending. Heaven's young team star hath fixed her Polish car. Her sleeping lord with handmaid lamb attending, and all about the courtly stable. Yeah. So at stable, at manger, Mary has laid her baby to rest. Mary has put baby Jesus Christ to sleep. While outside the barn, a group of angels are still attending Jesus Christ, still standing. They are standing ready to take his orders. Okay, that's a very summary of Nativity Odd. 31 stanza on the morning of Christ's nativity. So the main theme of this poem is the birth of Jesus Christ and overthrow of pagan God, and how the peace, justice, truth have returned to earth after the birth of Jesus Christ. And other side, the symbolic half of the poem talks about how people of England were able to enjoy peace, happiness, and other kind of privilege previously enjoyed only by the privileged class under Charles I. It is after the coming of Oliver Cromwell, only people of England, I mean common people of England, were able to enjoy these kind of things. Okay, I hope you understood the poem. Do you have any doubt in on Christ's nativity? Hello, are you people there?
Yes, ma'am.
May yes, please ma'am. read the poem. It's not that difficult. Only thing, there are a lot of references over here, but it is provided at the back of your textbook. If you read this poem, you will understand. Now, moving on to next poem. One second. Lycidas. Very important. This poem is pretty important. Or nativity odd is also important. This one is also important. Okay. Lycidas is also very important. One second. So, Lycidas was written in 1637 as a pastoral elegy. I hope you know what a pastoral elegy is. What is pastoral? Pastoralism in literature. Can somebody tell me what is pastoral poems? What are pastoral poems? Pastoralism, pastoral elegy. Are you familiar with the term pastoral? Hello?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So pastoralism in literature,
church-related.
Not church related. See, pastoralism in literature is an attitude in which poet looks at life from shepherd's angle. He'll be mourning someone. Elegy is mostly about lamenting upon the death of some favorite person, about a favorite person. So in such type of poems, poet will take the role of shepherd. He will present himself as a shepherd, and he will discuss about the life from the angle of shepherd, from a shepherd's angle. You understood what a pastoral life. See, if you are lamenting the death of, the poet will be lamenting the death of his favorite person. He will present himself as a shepherd and his favorite person also as another shepherd. And he will look upon life from a shepherd's angle. That is said to be a pastoral elegy. These kinds of poems are mostly set in woods, forest, riverside. Okay, now let us see. So Lycidas was written in 1637 as a pastoral elegy. It first appeared in 1638 collection of elegies entitled Gesta Eduardo King Naufrago, dedicated to the memory of Edward King. Edward King was the best friend of John Milton. They were together there at Christ College, Cambridge University. They were best friends. They studied together at Cambridge University, but he was drowned to death in a shipwreck in Irish Sea in 1637. Okay, in 1637, he was drowned to death in Irish Sea. So let me tell you, this kind of, pastoral elegy or pastoral songs, mostly shepherd songs. I already told you, dithyrambs, drama, all kind of art forms. Have been originated by shepherds, shepherds of Greece. Okay, so the origin of all art forms to shepherds. So Theocritus and Virgil, both are Roman poets. They are Roman poets. Theocritus and Virgil. So Theocritus of Sicily and Roman poet Virgil were believed to be the developers of pastoral elegy. I repeat, Theocritus, Theocritus, Theocritus of Sicily, and the Roman poet Virgil were believed to be the originators of pastoral elegy. And Lycidas is one of the greatest pastoral elegies ever written in English. So the poem is about 193 lines and irregularly rhymed. Okay, so Dr. Johnson, a famous critic of the 18th century, remarked that where there is leisure for fiction, there is a little grief. Okay, so we are able to pen something great isn't it? We are able to pen something great when we are emotional. If we are happy, if we are in a happy state, or if we don't have any kind of pestering or any kind of sorrow, of course we'll be leading a normal life. But if we are seriously sad, or if we are way down, obviously we'll be able to write something what fruitful. The pastoral elegy is a poem about death and idyllic rural life. Often pastoral elegy features shepherds. The Rana is actually a subgroup of pastoral poetry, as the elegy takes the pastoral elements and relate them to expressing grief at a loss. Once again, so key features of pastoral poetry. I'm telling you the various features of pastoral elegy: invocation of muse, expression of shepherds, poet's grief, praise of the disease. A tirade against the death, detailing of the effects of specific death upon the nature, eventually the poet's simultaneous acceptance of the death, inevitability, hope for immortality, symbolism through flowers, refrain, and rhetorical questions. So, class, if you're getting a question, discuss Lycidas as an elegy. What makes Lycidas an elegy? So, if you're asked such a essay question for exam, you're supposed to write all these features, and you have to support those these features in the poem. So like the previous poems, epithalamium, prothalamium, all those poets of medieval literature, they have a tendency to invoke the muses before they write something great, before they write something special. They will always invoke the muse. If it is an pastoral elegy, obviously characters will be, I'm telling you again, characters will be shepherds. So, and he or she will be praising the deceased person, the dead person. They will be praising the dead person, and they will be blaming death for stealing the person before he could burst into fame. Now, the next part, what author discusses in the poem is how the death of the particular person has affected the nature, how the death of his favorite person has affected the nature. In the coming stanza, he will be trying to accept the death. Okay, death is inevitable. That will come to all. He will try to console himself. Then he will say that, oh, that person had gone for goodness. Actually, he has elevated to higher position. He has attained immortality. Like that, the poem will end with an optimistic note. That is the very, that are the very key features of pastoral poetry. I hope you understood the features. Now, is it clear what is a pastoral poetry? Is
yes,
it clear?
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, in pastoral elegy, the deceased is often recasted as a shepherd. I told you, the dead person is presented as a shepherd despite what his role may have been in life. Further, after being recast as a shepherd, the deceased is often surrounded by a classical mythology figure such as nymphs, fauns, etc. Let me tell you, in Spencer's Epithalamion and Prothalamion, we have come across a lot of Greek, Roman allusions, isn't it? Mythology. So here also, in pastoral elegy also, poet will compare the characters to Greek or Roman characters. Okay, elegy is not mere an expression of sense of loss. Elegic poet engages himself in a discursive reflection. Actually, that is elegy is a product of deep meditation, a deep thought. Now, one second. Just hold for a second. So this Lycidas has got a prologue, epilogue, and three sections. Let's see. So prologue, first section that serves as a prologue to the poem runs through the first 24 lines. Here, one second, class. Page number 52. The first section that serves as a prologue to the poem runs through the first 24 lines. Here, Milton invokes the muses and explains the reason for writing the poem. Although Milton had decided not to write the poetry till his powers matured, bitter constraints had sad occasion compelled the poet to attempt an elegy. That occasion is untimely death of Lycidas, his friend, Edward King. Lycidas is none other than Edward King. Actually, Edward King is presented as Lycidas in this poetry. Yet once more, oh, your laurel, and once more, you myrtles brown, with ivy never seed, I come to pluck your berries, harsh crude, and with forced fingers rude, shatter your leaves before the mellowing ear. Bitter constraint and sad occasion, dear, compels me to disturb your season dew. For Lycidas is dead, dead. Over his prime, young Lycidas hath not left his peer. So in the poem starts with an invocation to muses. He compares himself to a shepherd plucking berries and laurels, and myrtle before the mellowing time. So our poet Milton is plucking berries and berries, laurels and myrtle. Poet described Lycidas and himself spending there. Actually, he and his friend, that is Edward King, who is presented as Lycidas in the poetry, they have spent their time in solitary, in the nature solitude, writing poetry and, writing poetry. So, and he hasn't decided, actually Milton doesn't have any thought of writing any serious kind of poetry because he knows that he hasn't matured yet. But he was forced to write such an elegy because his favorite person, his best friend, has departed, has gone away from him. And that was an untimely death of his Lycidas. So that has made him to write. Anyway, let me tell you, this poem has got a prologue, epilogue, and some five sections. And there are two digressions, interruptions in the poem, digressions in the poem. I repeat, this is a pastoral elegy, mourned the death of Edward King, and where Milton presented himself and his friend as shepherds, who were studying, who were friends and classmates in the Cambridge University. They were two good students. Actually, his friend Edward King was about to burst into a blaze of fame, but death has stolen him. So here Milton is complaining why death has taken him. So he's also asking nymphs, other goddesses, why can't they save him? Why don't they save him? Because it was in a shipwreck that Milton lost his friend Edward King. Then Milton consoles himself that, see, Muse Callipo, she couldn't even save her son Orpheus. I have already mentioned about Orpheus in Epithalamium. Orpheus is was a Greek musician. Okay, so she couldn't even save her son Orpheus. Then how come she could save our Edward King? Anyway, that was an untimely death because this person was very favorite to his juniors, teacher, everyone. He and his friend were not ordinary poets. Actually, ordinary poet has a tendency of writing poems about ladies, about the beautiful hair and all. But he and his friend were not like that because they were Puritan poets. Okay, they were Puritan poets. They wrote only about religious things, pure things. They only spoke about God and his ways. So after that, he makes two digressions. There are two digressions. There are two interruptions in the poem. So he mentions a procession, a procession mourning the death of Edward King. Hmm? So in that procession, you can see Neptune, Titans, then so many other Greek goddesses. Okay. So in that procession, someone else has joined. That is none other than Saint Peter. Saint Peter. So Saint Peter is the one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. Hmm? And yeah. So when he comes to earth, when he joined the procession mourning the death of Edward King, he sees many corrupt clergymen. He sees many corrupt clergymen and he scolds them. There are three types of corrupted clergy in men in church. They are creep, some are creep, some intrude, some climb. Some people are very cunning. Some people are and clergymen are very lazy and some are very ambitious. So according to Saint Peter, there are three types of clergymen. Some are very cunning, some are very lazy, some are very ambitious. Anyway, they joined church for their belly's sake, so as to amass money. It is not to worship king or to uplift the downtrodden. It is only for their sake they have joined the church. Now, so yeah. So after the two digressions, he says that, Milton come back to the pastoral elegy. He invites the valley, valley to cast their flowers and pray fragrance upon the dead body of Lycidas. I told you they were mourning the death of Edward King. So Milton is asking the entire valley to cast flowers upon the death of Edward King. Then poem ends with a note of joy and hope. This hope is based on a Christian belief that Lycidas has resurrected on the third day with the help of Jesus Christ, who walked on the waves of the sea. Lycidas rose up to the heaven just as sun rises up in the eastern horizon. So our Edward King, who had died in the shipwreck, he will be resurrected by the Jesus Christ. Now he has joined the group of saints and angels in heaven. So he should not be mourned. Milton is asking rest of the people that he should not be mourned, but they should be happy because his friend has been resurrected. Now he is in the company of angels. Angels are there in the heaven to protect him from evils. So shepherd who sang this pastoral elegy goes to new pastor, that is Milton, is going to a different place because he cannot live in this place any longer where memories of his friend haunt him day night. So that's the way summary of Lycidas. So in Lycidas you can see even though it's an elegy where normally poets use Greek and Roman mythology, but here being a Puritan poet, he couldn't help himself bringing Christian elements to the poetry, because we have seen in the previous poem his aversion towards pagan culture, and he loved Christian philosophy. So he has managed to incorporate Christian philosophy and stories from Bible in Lycidas. So Lycidas is a very beautiful poem. It's an elegy, a pastoral elegy, where he mourns the death of his friend, Edward King. He is presented as Lycidas. He was drowned in a shipwreck in 1637. When the poem starts, he invokes the muses and he says that he was not in a mood to compile poetry because he is not matured yet to write great things. He's simply plucking, he is a shepherd plucking berries, laurels, myrtle before the mellowing time. He doesn't know the right time to pluck those things. That is why he says that he's not matured yet. But still he is forced to write a poem. Why? Because he lost his favorite friend, Edward King. He was such a studious student. Edward King was a friend and classmate of Milton. And he was such a studious student. Their juniors actually admired them. They were compared to satyrs. They were compared to Greek deities of Roman Greek. I mean, yeah, they were compared to Greek deities. Even their teachers admired and appreciated them. I mean, Milton and Edward King. So then in second part, in first digression, Milton complains. See, nature or the world is very cruel because his friend Edward King was about to become famous. He was about to become a great person. But before that, nature has stolen him. Nature has stolen him. So he was asking nymphs, why can't they save him? Why they were so helpless when he was facing the death? Then he understood that even the great goddess or the muse Calypso couldn't save her own son, Orpheus, when he faced death by a mad woman of Thrace. Now, so the first digression is about fame. Milton's first digression in the poem is about fame. Now, he says that he and his friend Edward King have never written any poems on women or praising their physical features. They are matured poets. They are Puritan poets. They write only lofty themes. Poems about lofty themes. They only talked about God and goddesses, especially Jesus Christ. Okay. In second digression, he speaks about his attitude towards religion. Attitude towards religion. That is, they are mourning the death of Edward King, right? So the procession is going. So many mourners have joined the procession. Neptune, so many Greek gods like that. So the last one to join the procession is Saint Peter. Saint Peter is one of the disciples of Jesus Christ. He became very angry seeing the false fake priest, fake clergymen of that day, because they are very corrupted. He classifies those clergymen into three groups. Some are very cunning, some are very shrewd, and some are very ambitious. They all join the church for their belly's sake. Okay, so these are the two digressions. I told you there are two digressions, one on fame, another one on religion. So after two digressions, Milton comes back to the pastoral elegy. He invites the valley and other mountain flowers to join the death of Lycidas, and he is asking the valley to cast its flower on the dead body of Lycidas. Okay. But after that poem ends with a joy, a note of joy and hope, because he says that Lycidas is actually, he's not actually dead. Actually, he's resurrected by Jesus Christ. Now he's walking on the waves of the sea. So mourners should stop mourning. Those people who are lamenting at the death of Lycidas should stop now, because he has joined the company of Jesus Christ and angel in the heaven. Now they are his guardians. He is actually, his position is actually elevated. Now he has become divine. Okay. So whatever, now without Lycidas, this shepherd, that is Milton, is alone in that area. So day and night, his memories are haunting the shepherd, that is Milton. So Milton couldn't, he can't live there anymore. So he planned to move to some other place. So that is the very theme of Lycidas. Now, the next two poems, L'Allegro, L'Allegro and Penisro. L'Allegro and Penisro are two companion poems, okay. One second. L'Allegro is a pastoral poem by John Milton, published in 1645 poems composed shortly after Milton left Cambridge. L'Allegro means happy man. The title L'Allegro means happy man. It's in Italy. Okay, in Italian language, L'Allegro means a happy man. Now, they served as a balance to each other. L'Allegro was talks about a young man and his ways. And Penisro is about a matured man. L'Allegro, along with Il Penisro, explore the contrast in generic, yonric terms, the ideal pleasures appropriate to contrasting lifestyle that a poet might choose or might not choose at different times. So when you are at 16, 18, 19, your ways will be very jovial, very lively. But when you reach the age of 40 or 45, you will become very serious. So this L'Allegro is a happy poem, a jovial poem, whereas Il Penisro is a serious poem that talks about a poet ways at different times. Now, L'Allegro celebrate Grace Euphrosyne, that means goddess of mirth, goddess of happiness. In L'Allegro, actually, when we are young, we always want to be happy, isn't it? So we look for those ways which bring happiness to us. So here in this poem, Milton invokes goddess Grace Euphrosyne through the traditional theocritic and pastoral model. I told you Theocritus. Theocritus is the originator of pastoral elegy, pastoral poems. So he is invoking, like any other poem, he is invoking Euphrosyne, goddess of happiness. The poem is playful and is set with the pastoral scene that follows the main character to connect with the flock stories and fairy tales. So there is a progress from the pleasure found in L'Allegro with the pleasure found in Il Penisro. So, I mean, the hero of L'Allegro is pretty happy by seeing the beautiful nature or beautiful things around. But the character that you see in Il Penisro, he is not happy with beautiful things because he knows that all those beautiful things are simply betraying his eyes, simply deluding in form. All those beautiful things are not actually beautiful. They are deluding us. That is the very philosophy of Il Penisro. Poem invokes mirth and other allegorical figures of joy, merriment, extols the active and cheerful life while depicting a day in countryside according to this philosophy. So in this L'Allegro, Milton is describing his life in countryside and how he takes part in different festivals. The poem in its form and content is similar to Dithyrambs to Bacchus or hymns to Venus. Actually, it is from Dithyrambs, God songs or songs of shepherd. I told you Dithyrambs means songs of shepherd or God songs. It is from Dithyrambs, dramas, plays have originated. Okay, so this poem is written in the form of Dithyrambs. Poems have been classified into various genres by various scholars. L'Allegro and Penisro, okay, such as academic writing, a pastoral, a classical philosophy, and the classical hymn. This poem, these two companions poem can be classified into these many ways, academic writing, pastoral, classical, and So speaker in L'Allegro argues for living a life full of pleasure because he is very young. So the cheerful man wants to be happy. So the poem begins with an invocation of God, Luth, melancholy and personified as horrific creature. So in this poem, he describes melancholy, sadness. Goddess melancholy has a horrific creature. He doesn't want the company of, he hates the company of melancholy. in the place of this monster, the cheerful poet welcomes you frozen. He's asking, oh, come on, get away, melancholy. I don't want your company. He's asking you frozen. That is goddess of mirth, to accompany him. Actually, goddess of mirth, happiness, is considered to be the daughter of Venus and goddess Venus and Bacchus. Bacchus, I hope you know who is Bacchus. Bacchus is the Roman version of Dionysius. Bacchus is the god of wine, madness, sex, all kind of, art forms that can convince human being. Actually, Bacchus is the son of Zeus, born to an earthly woman. Okay, Zeus had he had born many demigods like Hercules. All these demigods are born to earthly women. So Bacchus was very handsome, very handsome when he was born. Seeing this Zeus' wife, Hera, became very angry, and Bacchus lost his head. She cursed Bacchus, and he lost his head. And Zeus has restored Bacchus' head with that of a bull. So you might have seen in English movies, a person with bull, a bull-headed person. God of war, god of battle, wine, sex, madness, everything. So happiness is the daughter of Venus and Bacchus. See, class, we have a similar kind of story in Hindu mythology. Can you relate that story, the story of Bacchus, to any of our god?
Yes, ma'am. Ganapati.
Yes, exactly. So, yeah. So in this poem, our poet is invoking goddess of happiness. Here Milton has made some alternations in the poem for the sake of his writing. He has made some alternation. Originally, happiness is the son, daughter of Venus and Bacchus. But in the poem, he depicts goddess happiness as the son, son of Zephyrus, West Wind, and Aurora, the goddess of dawn. The poet invites Mirth together with mountain nymph, Sweet Liberty, to take him as one of her followers to live in a unreproved, pleasure-free. So he's asking goddess happiness to bring all her followers liberty. See, let me tell you, so many qualities have been personified in this section. One second. Hold just a second. Yes. So, class, Milton is asking goddess happiness to bring jolly, jest, youth, sports, laughter, liberty to bring with her. Okay. He has personified all happy qualities, all qualities that bring happiness to a person to bring with her. Okay. And take him to some happy place. The poem is it's a fancy poem where Milton, a day is spent in a countryside, taking part in various type of activities. Okay, so here the poet Milton becomes a spectator rather than a participant. So he's describing various type of activities in that countryside. Yes. Now we have three more poems. My God, I'm moving. Now moving to L'Allegro. L'Allegro is done. Then, oh yeah, Il Pensiero. So Il Pensiero is the companion poem of L'Allegro. This poem he has written in his matured phase. So in his matured phase, he understood that, see, goddess happiness has actually nothing to do with his life. Actually, she is a fake. She is deluding him. Who is real? Il Pensiero. Il Pensiero means serious man, a contemplative man, a thoughtful man. In Italian word, Il Pensiero means a serious man, a pensive man. So in this poem, he says, he believes that melancholy is real. Goddess of melancholy is real. But goddess of joy, happiness, she is not real. Actually, she is the one who betrayed him, betrays some people from reality. The speaker in Il Pensiero begins his argument in a similar way by banishing vain deluding joy, the crew that guides L'Allegro. Actually, in the previous poem, L'Allegro, poet is guided by happiness, goddess of happiness. But in this poem, he says that he doesn't want the company of goddess happiness because she's actually deluding him, betraying him, taking his, diverting his path. So he doesn't want the company of Pensiero, the goddess of happiness. Poem expresses the joys of solitary man walking abroad during the evening, sitting studying at night in the midst of quiet woodlands, or finding pleasure in the tragic and heroic literature and in mystic churches. So the person in the L'Allegro, he was happy in the company of people, rustic people. He's taking part in various kind of festival, wedding, feast and all. He's taking part in all kind of countryside activities. Okay. But person in Il Pensiero, he is a solitary man. He wants to walk alone through convent side. He wants to sit and study at night. He loves to he takes pleasure in reading tragic and heroic literature. He's a reclusive man. Then, so he rejects happiness because it is trivial, it is silly. So goddess of sorrow, goddess of melancholy, she is the daughter of Saturn and Vesta, divine fire. I repeat, she is the daughter of Saturn and divine Vesta, and she is as beautiful as the Ethiopian queen Cassiopeia. Now she speaker invites melancholy to be his companion, and just like he told to goddess of happiness to bring just youth, sports, laughter to bring with her in L'Allegro, he asks melancholy to bring her followers such as peace, quiet, fasting, leisure, contemplation to bring with her. Let me tell you, actually, these two poems are full of personifications. Abstract qualities have been personified. Peace, quiet, fasting, leisure, contemplation. These are the qualities that you can only find in a matured person, isn't it? Matured person. So he has personified these things. He says that peace, quiet, fast, leisure, contemplation, etc. are followers of melancholy. Whereas sports, jolly, laughter, etc. are followers of happiness. Okay. So this person actually wants the companionship of melancholy. He welcomes nightingale song to interrupt the silence. So none of the country sounds or society is for him. He would prefer to wander solitary in the moonlight through woods and meadows or walk near the seashore. So person in L'Allegro, he was pretty happy with the company of shepherds, rustic people. He was happy to take part in sports, wedding and all. But this person doesn't want to take part in any kind of activity. He wants to be alone. He wants to walk alone under the moonlit night through wind woods. So, yeah. And in his matured phase, He wants to read the books of Tasso, Chaucer, Edmund Spenser. He wants to read Greek and Latin literature, so has to gain wisdom. So when the morning comes, melancholy, so he speaker is asking to escort him to some lonely pastures. He's asking melancholy to escort him to some forest so that he can contemplate about his favorite subject. Now, so when he walks, when he falls asleep near a brook, then up, on waking, he wishes to hear the mysterious music of the nature. Here, this person doesn't want to mingle with people. Instead, he loves to have the company of nature. He loves to get himself immersed in the company of nature. He wished to become a prophetic figure. Or else you can say that this person, unlike L'Allegro, not able to find happiness in silly or in trivial things. He needs higher kind of, higher type of happiness. Or bookish, the happiness that one receives from book. So that's all about L'Allegro and Penisro. Now moving on to sonnet. Sonnets. So you have two sonnets in your block four, sonnet number 19 and sonnet number 23. Let me tell you, both these sonnets are of autobiographical type. Sonnet 19 and sonnet 23 are autobiographical. One second, class. Just a second. Okay, so when I consider how my light is spent, when I consider how my light is spent, here half my days in this dark world wide, and that one talent which is death to hide, lodged with useless, though my soul more bent to serve there my maker and present, my true account less he returning child, doth God exact day labor light denied. So in this sonnet, we know that first part is first sets it full of questions. First part is full of question, and the last part he reunites with God, just like George Herbert. We have discussed George Herbert's poetry in the last class. So George Herbert, at the in the beginning lines, he is actually complaining gods about the ways how the God has given so many trials and tribulations to George Herbert. He'll be complaining. He's complaining against all those things. But towards the end, we can see we had seen that a poet has actually reunited with God. In this poem also, John Milton is actually, he's a blind poet, right? He has lost his eyesight at the age of 39 or 40. So he's asking, see, when I consider how my light is spent, he doesn't hear half my days in this dark world wide. Actually, he had spent his light, that means vision, his eyesight in a dark world. And that one talent which is death to hide. And see, let me tell you, if you have a talent, if God have given you some talent, you have to use it. You have to utilize it. But this person actually, he hasn't used that talent when he had eyesight. Let me tell you something. When Milton had eyesight, when he had the vision, he left his talent unused. But he lost his eyesight now. Okay, now he lost his eyesight. Now only he has attained the true vision. So he's asking how God can expect labor from a blind man. Even when he had the vision, he couldn't serve the God. But how come the God expect labor from a blind man? But one thing he says, when he had the vision, he actually he spent his life in darkness. But when he lost his vision only, he got the real light. So he's asking, after denying vision to him, how can God expect labor from him? At that time only he heard the murmur soon replies. See the first eight lines, octave followed by a set. Set. First eight lines are full of questions, and last six lines are answers to the questions in the eight lines. Okay, so this is written in Petrarchan rhyming scheme. A B B A, C D C D C D. That is the rhyming scheme of this sonnet, Petrarchan. Okay. So in this stanza, he gets the answer that God doesn't need the labor gifts from man. Okay, God doesn't need any labor from man. He doesn't need any man's service. He just want man to utilize his talent, the talent that he had given to man. Actually, God has given a mild yoke, a mild burden to everyone, so has to serve him best. So his state is kingly. God is actually here. Milton again equates God to that of a king, as he always equates. Okay, so here he says that God doesn't need the service of man because he himself is a king and he has thousands of servants as angels. So many angels are there in the heaven to carry out his order. He doesn't want the labor of man. God only wants man to utilize his talent that he has given to them. I told you this is a sonnet, octave followed by set. So in first, in octave he'll be asking so many questions. In the set, those questions will be answered. So in the octave part, he says that he spent his light in darkness. When he had the vision, he was living a dark life. But suddenly, when he lost the vision, he realized the real mission of his life. Then only he gained the true sight, inner sight. But at that time, how can God expect work from him, labor from him? Why did God deny light to him? So how can he work for God? How can he serve God? At that time only he got the answer that God doesn't need the help of man, or he doesn't need the labor of man, because God has thousands of angels to carry out his order. God only needs man to work on his gift. More only want man to utilize his talents. Okay, that is the very meaning of sonnet number 90, which is highly autobiographical. Now we are moving on to sonnet number 23. Me thought I saw my late espoused saint. So let me tell you, Milton had married twice, and he had lost two wives. His two wives have died in childbirth. First wife's name is Mary Powell. Second wife's name is Catherine Woodcock. So according to critics, some says that he had addressed this poem to his second wife, Catherine Woodcock. Some says that he had addressed this poem to Mary Powell, first wife. Some other group says that actually he had addressed both his wife. Okay, me thought I saw my late espoused saint brought me to like Alistus from grave, whom Jove, great son, to her glad husband gave, rescued from death by force, though pale and faint. So in this poem, here, he says that Milton had seen his recently deceased wife in his dream. Brought to me like Alice from the grave. So Alicetus means in Euripides' play, Alicetus, the heroine, sacrifices her life to save her husband, Admetus. And she is rescued from death by Hercules. Okay. So here he says that in his dream, he saw his recently deceased wife. Just like Alicetus who was rescued by Hercules. Whom Jove's great son is Hercules to her glad husband gave. Actually, Alicetus sacrificed her life for her husband. But Hercules has saved her from the death and he gave her back to her husband. Similarly, Milton also saw his wife in his dream. Rescued from the death by force, and though pale and faint, she appeared to be very pale and faint. She is a diseased person, right? So pale and faint. Mine as whom washed from the spot of childbed taint, purification in old and low did save, and such as yet once more I trust to have full sight of her in heaven without restraint. So let me tell you here, he says that he equates the his wife to that that of heaven. She is not impure, she is pure. She is an heavenly object. She has passed away, right? Now she is in heaven, so she is very much pure. Came vested all in white, pure has her mind. So now she appeared in white cloth. She's a deceased person, so she came in white just like angels. So her cloth as well as her mind both are white. That means she is very much pure. Her face was veiled yet to my fancied sight. Love, sweetness, goddess in her person shine. So she is the epitome of all qualities, love, sweetness, etc. So clear has in no face with more delight. Oh, as to embrace me she inclined. I walked, she fled, and day brought back my night. So in his sleep, he saw his deceased wife just like Alcetus brought by Hercules, and he has given Alcetus to his to her husband. Similarly, Milton's wife has come in his dream. She appeared to be very divine, very pure, because she is a member of heaven. Her mind as well as her cloth both are white. She resembles all noble qualities, love, sweetness, goodness. One can see all those quality in her. But once Milton was about to embrace her, Milton was about to hug her, at that moment she disappeared. What happened? Day has come, and Milton has Milton's night had come back. His night had come back. When the day come back, Milton's night had started. Because he has now wake up from his dream. When Milton woke up from his dream, his lady love has disappeared. That is why he says that day brought back my night. Usually during daytime we will get light, but here, when he understood that it was only a dream, not reality, he became very sad. He couldn't embrace, he couldn't hug his wife. So he says that day has actually brought night, not light. I hope you understood. It's a very simple poem. Do you have any kind of doubt? Hello? Hello?
Yes,
ma'am. Please read the poem. Please read this section. It is easy, but you can see that there are so many Greek, then Roman, Christian elements are there in Milton's poem. Milton is a Puritan poet. Okay. So you can see a lot of biblical elements, biblical as well as Greek mythology, Greek elements. Okay. Block number four. Okay. So if there is no doubt, I'm winding up. Next section, we'll start with block five. Okay.
Thank you,
then. Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.